of the inadequate reporting system, but also because of the secrecy that surrounds them. Numerous social and behavioral factors are involved in the spread of sexually transmitted diseases. We understand from social workers' point of view, the broken homes, sexual disharmony, urbanization and industrialization, then social disruption, changing behavioral patterns, social stigma, alcoholism, drug addiction, all those could be the social factors. Today, let us try to learn more about sexually transmitted diseases through this webinar from the experts. At the beginning, let me welcome all those who are participating in this webinar. First and foremost, it's our pleasure to have Dr. Somil Rastogi, Trustee and Secretary, Sukham Foundation, New Delhi. Long time back, we had interaction with Sir, and we had a very good, fruitful session with Sir on substance abuse. We remember that, and remembering that good thoughts, one day I called Dr. Somil Rastogi to find out whether we could have some program like this. Immediately, Dr. Somil Rastogi responded, and within a week, today we are in a position to organize this webinar. All this is because of the kind cooperation of Dr. Somil Rastogi. Warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Yes. And we are indeed very happy to have our resource person, Dr. Surendra Kumar, Associate Professor in SMS Medical College, Jaipur, MBBS from Institute of Medical Sciences, MD Skin and Venereal Diseases from same Institute of Medical Sciences. And he has 14 years of experience in dermatology and sexually transmitted diseases. And 15 research papers are published in cited journals. And he is a speaker at various conferences at national as well as international level. And he is a PhD guide for postgraduate students. It's really very, we are very proud, and indeed we are lucky to have you as a resource person. Warm welcome to you, Dr. Surendra Kumar.
Thank you.
And all this is possible because of the support of our principal, Dr. Julius C.J., who is always encouraging and with us. Warm welcome to you, dear principal madam, Dr. Juliet C.J.
Thank you, ma'am.
And also, one more support, all the time encouraging us, is our vice principal, Dr. Janice Mary. Warm welcome to you, dear Dr. Janice Mary.
Thank you, ma'am.
We are indeed very happy to have all the BSW and some of the BA faculty are with us. And our BSW students are in full strength participating in this program because they are very eager to learn from the expert. That also, we are very happy to have some connection with the people from Delhi. I think this pandemic has given us this a chance to have this kind of a webinar who are far away from us. Otherwise, we would generally have from the neighborhood. So this has given us this opportunity to have this kind of interaction with the experts from New Delhi. Warm welcome to all our faculty members, students, and all the teaching staff, one and all. With this brief introduction, let me invite Dr. Somil Rastogi, Trustee and Secretary of Sukham Foundation, New Delhi, to deliver the keynote address. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, madam. So, first of all, I would like to thank Dr. Vinita and Principal Madam and Vice Principal Madam for giving us this wonderful opportunity to interact with this wonderful audience. Thank you. And secondly, I really hope in this difficult time of Corona, you all are keeping yourself safe as well as your family safe. because it's our bigger social responsibility, not only to keep ourselves safe, but to keep our family as well as the neighborhood safe. So I really wish you are all doing well and are safe in this difficult time of corona. And as ma'am correctly said, any problem, they have their roots in the society and they have their social implications. So this topic of sexual transmitted diseases, it also has its branches in the society in various forms. So if I say, so it's really important to have a session like this on the topic, which is, usually people are shy to discuss. So as a part of social work fraternity, you all must understand, when you shed off your shyness, then only you will be able to speak up loudly in public on any topic. So you must be first of all comfortable to understand the topic, the magnitude of the problem, and then only you will be able to discuss and convey the message to the society in various forms. In your future life, when you work with a certain NGO which is working in any field, especially in sexual transmitted diseases or infection, so you will be in better position to speak up when you will be shedding off all the shyness. So, if I say STI, so it is a broader form of, it has broader form. So STD is a part of STI. STI in a larger form also includes other infections like HIV, like human papillomavirus infections. So sexually transmitted infection is a very broad term. So here in this webinar, we will be focusing ourselves in STDs only. And if I say STD, as per WHO, almost 340 million people are being affected by various kind of STDs, mainly four types of STDs all over the world. So you can understand the issue of the problem. And people are very much shy of sharing their problem. They are shy of going to the clinics to avail the treatments available, and these are all curable and these can be also preventable. So huge social stigma is associated with all the sexually transmitted diseases. So as a part of social worker fraternity, you must understand your roles and responsibility, in which way you can take the message to the society to fight this public health threat of sexually transmitted diseases. And you can understand the social stigma related to STD. I'm not sure, but it is rumored that even our first Prime Minister of India, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, was considered to have a STD and he died of STD. It is rumored, I don't know, because it's such a social stigma. Even our historian doesn't say it clearly, ki our first Prime Minister was also having a STD. So you can understand the problem associated with this. So I will not take much of the time, and I would like to, it is really an honor to have Dr. Surendra Kumar with us, because he has also got his corona duty, and he spared his valuable time from his COVID duty, and he is now with us to address the audience on this very important topic of STD. So now it's all over to Dr. Surendra Kumar to enlighten us about the issue. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Soumit. Thank you, Vinita Men. Actually, in fact, it's my honor to teach the students this STD, basically. First of all, I would like to thank this Sukham Foundation due to which it has been made possible to deliver such a lecture. Sexually transmitted diseases or STI, sexually transmitted infections are, in fact, social stigma, a big social stigma.
Excuse me, Dr. Surendra Kumar.
Yeah.
Can you increase your volume? Thank you, sir.
Is it audible?
No.
Little better. Feel it has to be.
Now?
Not okay.
No, sir. Cannot hear.
Now?
No.
Is it audible?
No, sir.
STIs and STDs, they are basically a bigger social stigma nowadays we are facing in our clinical practice, like in practicing dermatology. I'm practicing as a dermatologist as well as a sexologist or a venereologist. So there are a lot of social stigmas associated with this disease, but main focus of my presentation, I would like to keep it on scientific aspect basically of the sexual diseases, because that is the part basically I can teach you in a more scientific way. Okay, so I am just going to start my presentation. First of all, these are the broad heading under which I will discuss the STIs. First of all, introduction, then scope and burden of the problem, then what are the sexually transmitted infections, then along with that, how to approach a case of sexually transmitted infections, then different STIs like bacterial, viral and other STIs, then what is the syndromic approach to STIs, and maybe in the last, if time permits, then we will go for some MCQs and some photo quiz, okay? So, defining STIs, basically they are a group of communicable diseases that are transmitted by sexual contact and then caused by a wide range of either bacterial or viral or protozoal or fungal agents or ectoparasites. So, any infection which can be transmitted by sex, whether it can be vaginal, anal or oral, it is called sexually transmitted infection. But there are some of the diseases which only manifest at the sexual organs and initially, and then they manifest at other parts of the body. So they are STDs. So STDs, basically five diseases are included into STDs. Other diseases which are transmitted by this sexual route, they are considered under one umbrella term, STI, but they are not STDs. So STI is a broader umbrella term which includes all STDs as well as all the diseases which can transmit by sexual route. Whether the first lesion appears at the genitals or whether it appears at other parts, that is not a problem. So STDs, the initial lesion appears at the genital parts, while in STIs, it includes STDs as well as the other diseases which transmits by STI. Like, I will like to give an example, that is like HIV. So it spreads via sexual act, but there are other routes also. Sexual route is not the only route for it, like injection misuse, then multiple routes are there for transmission of HIV. And likewise, scabies. Scabies is one infection which can spread as such also. Means anyone who keeps a longer contact with the person who is having scabies, then also he can get scabies. But note he can have sex or not. Okay. So STI is in broader term. STDs are diseases whose first presentation is on the genital parts. So scope of the burden means like you are able to see in the this world map, basically the main burden, it's a huge burden, and India also is one of the countries who has been affected by sexual problems. So more than 1 million acquire an STI every day. So this is the burden which we are having. And every year 500 million acquire one of the four major STIs. And more than 290 million have HPV infections of the total 500 million. And as such, we know that HIV, risk of acquiring HIV also increases by the STIs. So there are five classical STDs which we include, like syphilis, gonorrhea, chancroid, donovanosis, and LGV. These are five total STDs we list, which are classical STDs basically we include. Rest other diseases that are more than 30 and they comes under one umbrella term, that is STI. So this is the expanded classification of STIs according to the causative agent, and as you know, treponema pallidum, this causes syphilis, Haemophilus leucaeus, this causes chancroid, and all these diseases. We will discuss it in following slides.
Sorry to disturb you, sir. Your slide is not moving. Slides are not moving. I think you should opt the option of full screen and then move the slide one by one, because in our screens we can see the only first slide.
Okay now it's visible.
Yes. Please opt the full screen mode. Opt for the full screen mode.
So this is the expanded classification I was talking about. To start with, treponema pallidum, it causes syphilis, then Haemophilus leucaeus causes chancroid, and all these pathogens which are specific for the specific STIs. Coming to the next slide, then all these agents, we will discuss them in following slides, okay? Then some bacteria, some protozoa, then some fungus, and then some ectoparasites also. So all these come under the heading of the STIs. So for diagnosing a STI, we should have a general history, then a contact with a patient or a person who is suspected of having STD, then its onset character, means five P's we need to ask regarding any STI, like means regarding the history of your sexual partners, then your sexual partners means sexual partners, how many of your sexual partners you are having, means that is very important. More will be the number of the sexual partners, more will be the chances that he or she will get STI. So multiple partners increases the risk STI in multiple. Then your practices, sexual practices, like vaginal sex or anal sex or it's oral sex, it depends on the type of the sex you are practicing, and then type of the partner also, like you are having, whether you are having male partner, whether you are having female partner, that is also important. Okay. So then your what protection during sex he or she uses. That is also important. So 5 P's. Yes, what are your partners, then your sexual practices, then protection from STDs. Whether he or she uses, male, if person is a male, whether he uses condoms for protection, whether he is using consistently or correctly, the use of condom in a consistent as well as in the correct way. That is very important. So, protection from STDs, whether he or she is using or not, then past history of any STD, whether it is present or not, and then what measures he or she is using for prevention of pregnancy. So all these 5 P's are important for investigating any case of STD. So the presenting complaints in STDs or STI may be either it may be a sore or an ulcer, which may be either painful or may be painless. In some diseases it is painless, like in syphilis, or in some diseases it is painful, like in herpes. So blood in urine, then that is also, these are the following symptoms which can be presenting signs, in fact, patient, or symptoms which patient can tell, and we should investigate regarding that. Whether there is rashes on the skin, burning sensation during urination, then whether there is itching or not, whether he or she is having any papules or pustules. Papules means small, hard, elevated lesions, so pustules means pulse-filled lesions. And then some warty lesions like rough surfaces, elevated lesions, warts, and or then unusual discharge from any sexual organ. These are the, these may be the presenting symptoms for STI. Sexual history means it's more important regarding this when you are for a social work and you go for, you just want to means ask or want to know from any person whether means what sexual history he or she should ask from a person who is suspected of having STD. Then number of exposure, obviously more will be the number of exposure, more will be the chances of getting STI. Then number of sexual partners, as already we have discussed. Then date of last sexual exposure, because some diseases have a definitive incubation period, like some this gonorrhea has shortest incubation period, only 48 to 72 hours is the incubation period. So it's very important. Means if any person is presenting 15 days after sex, then there is less or less chances that he or she has acquired gonorrhea. So date of last sexual exposure is very important, because incubation period of the diseases varies. Then sex of the partners, then history of male to male contact, like homosexual history is also important. Then type of intercourse, as I have already discussed. Then was it protected or was it not, but it was not non-protected. So that is also important. Then for HIV, suspecting HIV, these are the alarming signs of HIV. Means most of, many of the STIs, they occur in patients who are having HIV also, because the root, one root is the same, sexual route. HIV also spreads by the sexual route, and the STDs also happens with the same route. So alarming signs of HIV, like history of recurrent diarrhea, history of fever, history of loss of weight, that is more than 10 kg weight in 6 months, that's very important. Then history of genital ulcer disease, history of any blood transfusion, and history of herpes zoster or other opportunistic infections, that is also important. Then for examination, as I have already discussed, we will see for the lymph nodes, then any ulcers or any rashes, any
materials. So in main, we need to inspect all the genital organs, including penis, external meatus, atractic foreskin, then perianal area, lymph node examination, or rectal examination. All these things, it's many of the things are for to be used by medical specialists only. But still, as a social worker also, you should know what exactly you want to convey to the your superior authority, or you want to suspect any STI. So these things to be examined in the man as well as in the woman. Then systemic examination, that's used only medical stresses. So coming to the STIs now, what are the STIs or which are being which are more common nowadays? So coming to the common ones, first of all, the STIs which are being caused by bacterial agents. Coming to first one, it's syphilis. What Dr. Somil was discussing, there were strong rumors that Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru ji, he was first Prime Minister of India, he died of cardiosyphilis. Okay, so it might not be true, but there are rumors. Okay, so there is one classical saying regarding syphilis, that one night with Venus, a lifetime with Mercury. So this saying means one night of unprotected sex with any Venus was used to be means a symbol for a woman, a goddess, a beautiful means girl. It was a symbol of a beautiful girl. Once there was a sexual exposure or a person who had acquired the syphilis, then there will be, because the main treatment of syphilis used to be mercury. So, and the mercury has to be used for years in the past. Right now the treatments, better treatments are available, and it's very easy to treat syphilis. But in the past, this was a disease who was a lot more burden on the basically healthcare, and proper treatment was not work. Mercury was the only treatment. So one night with Venus and a lifetime with mercury. This was a popular saying with syphilis. It is caused by this agent Treponema pallidum, and so the contact with it transmits by contact with infectious moist lesions, most commonly during oral, anal, or vaginal sex, and less commonly through the skin-to-skin contact also. And it can transmit from mother to child also. And so there are three stages of the syphilis. One is primary syphilis, then secondary syphilis, and then tertiary syphilis. So primary syphilis occurs means most of the time a single ulcer is there that is painless, and it happens either in males at the glands and in the females at the labia majora most of the time. So in primary stage, the bacteria it inoculates and it forms a center and multiplies there, early latent, late latent, and then proper third stage. So in that case, it goes to other organs of the body and then destroys there also. So in primary syphilis, you are able to see that it presents with an ulcer. In secondary stage, it most of the time presents as a rash, and in third stage, most in early latent, it generally doesn't have any symptoms, in late latent, most of the time symptoms are not there, but other complications like this heart complications and related to main organs involved are heart. So cardiosyphilis is there, then nervous system, neurosyphilis is there, and then skeletal system, bones. These three major symptoms are involved after late latent syphilis. So coming to primary syphilis, as you already you are seeing in the photograph, it generally presents and a well-defined ulcer, that to a painless ulcer. It, ulcers of syphilis doesn't have any pain, and mostly it's single. Sometimes it can happen that person can have two ulcers also. Like mostly it's single ulcer, and the incubation period is 9 to 90 days. Okay, so if any person have sex with another person who is having disease, then after 9 to 90 days, on an average around 3 weeks, on an average around 3 weeks, he or she starts getting the ulcer. Okay, most of the time the presentation is at the genital area. Then these are the diagnostic tests, VDRL test, which is commonly practiced, and which is also for screening of the patients, because it is present in more than 95% of the patients, even in the primary stage also. And then confirmatory test is the TPHA test, or treponemal palatal immobilization test. In secondary syphilis, it appears 6 to 8 weeks after the appearance of primary chancre. And the symptoms are most of the time rash, generalized lymph node swelling, and the condyloma lata and mucus patches. So these are the lesions of secondary syphilis, like erythematous to coppery rash on the palms, as you are able to see on the right side picture. And these are the perianal lesions, like condyloma lata, these are called perianal warty lesions. So it happens 6 to 8 weeks after the primary stage. As I have already told, VDRL is almost always positive, so it's a very good test to screen these patients. And then TPHA is a test which we use for confirmation. And in latent syphilis means, if it is less than 1 year, then it is early latent. If it is more than 1 year, then it is late latent. That's why here comes the importance of the time where he or she has had sex in the past. And in this syphilis, most of the patients are asymptomatic, but some patients, they go to cardiosyphilis or neurosyphilis or in-skin cutaneous gromage, and then your bone involvement also in some profile. So in the diagnosis, we can add, it's very easy. And treatment is nowadays, injection benzathine, penicillin is very effective, and even a single injection is sufficient enough to cure in the primary, secondary, early latent. So this point you need to emphasize. I would like to emphasize that whenever you go to any person who is suspected of STD, just say him that most of the STDs are treatable nowadays with a very nominal treatment. So you need not to sigh, and person should come in front. Insist he or she must visit a dermatologist, a skin specialist. So there are some alternative regimes also in persons who are penicillin allergic. It's very important, because management of contacts, we need to break the chain of the infection. So management of the context is very important. Here comes your role. Basically, you have to have a high index of suspicion that who the person is having STI, and then basically just take him in the confidence, and then you get all the history, like past whatever we have discussed in the history part, and then just manage or encourage them to for the treatment of the sexual partners also, so that the chain of the infection breaks. That is very important in the STI prevention. And coming to the second disease, that is chancroid, it's also called as soft chancre because ulcer is very friable, soft. It is called by a bacteria, Haemophilus dubri. And so here incubation period is 3 to 7 days, and as with the presentation you are able to see that most of the site is frenulum, where the maximum friction happens in the male, while in females it's most of the time this vestibule. So investigation by simple microscopy and serology we are able to diagnose. The treatment is also very simple. Azithromycin 1 gram state dose is sufficient. Then coming to third STI, then this is LGB lymphogranuloma venereum, and it is caused by a bacteria, Chlamydia trachomatis. Is specific serovars L1, L2, L3 are responsible for LGB. And this disease also, it most of the time infects to the this lymph nodes, and then rest of the time this skin, then it lymph nodes, and then to the upper lymph nodes. Generally, after incubation period of 3 to 12 days, superficial ulceration, and which heals without scarring. Most of the time, ulcer is temporary and it's not passes unnoticed. This is the presentation of LGB. Like it can lead to penile elephantiasis as it affects the lymph node most of the time. And in females, it leads to vulval elephantiasis. You know, this is called osteomyoma. It's edema and swelling of the genital organs due to the lymphatic blockage. And by GIMSA, it can be confirmed. And coming to fourth STI, STD, this donovanosis. It's caused by a bacteria, Calimetobacter granulomatis, and it is known by various other names also, like ulcerating granuloma of the pudenda, granuloma gastroinguinal, then granuloma venereum genitoinguinal, and granuloma inguinal propitum. So the incubation period is 8 to 80 days. In syphilis, it's 9 to 90 days. In donovanosis, it's 8 to 80 days. And when biopsy is done, it shows a close septic in appearance. So, these are the ulcers which are of this donovanosis. Superficial ulcers with a exuberant growth. Sometimes it's phagedonic type also, like destructive or necrotic type, where ulcers are too much, like you are able to see in the second picture. Sometimes it's very destructive. So the presentation varies in each patient, but still a high index of suspicion should be given. GIMSA or Lesman stain are sufficient to make a diagnosis. Treatment azithromycin 1 gram single dose per week for 3 weeks, or until all the resolution of the lesions is the treatment of choice. Then coming to the urethritis, it's the broader term basically. Urethritis means inflammation of urinary tract. So it can be due to the bacteria, gonococcus, that is called gonococcal urethritis, and it may be due to other bacteria, that is called NGUV or non-gonococcal urethritis. So any pain and discharge, this is very specific symptom, pain and discharge from the urethra, it is urethritis. So coming to the gonococcal urethritis, here the bacteria is Neisseria gonorrhoeae, and incubation period, as I already told, most of the time it's 48 to 72 hours, but can appear as late as 5 to 7 days also. And most of the time it presents with purulent and bloody discharge from the urethra. And patient complaints of burning or pain when urinating. So pretense of frequent urination is there, but every time he goes for a urination, there will be severe pain, and he or she will not be able to avoid this completely. And then again there will be, in short time, there will be again a sense of this urination. Becomes slightly late. And the pain during urination is the main symptom in the females also. Diagnosis, there are various tests by which we can diagnose gonorrhea. Culture is most of the time informative, and these are the positive agents for non-gonococcal urethritis, means apart from gonorrhea. Treatment is very easy, sufficient, 400 mg single dose is sufficient. So nowadays, most of the STI, except HIV, they are most of the time treatable. So it's very important part is that the shyness from a person who already has got STD should be removed, and here comes your role. You need to take him or her in the confidence that you will not tell anything to anyone, and then you take proper history, proper sexual partners in the past, and get him ready for investigations and proper a venereological care. Then now coming to viral agents. So first of the time, herpes genitalis is caused by herpes simplex virus type 1 and type 2, and the incubation period is 2 to 20 days, most of the time 7 to 8 days on an average, and it is caused by simple touching. Most of the time by touching only it can happen, like lip to lip kissing, then your vaginal or oral sex, it can happen. So it presents with, and it's very easy to treat with acyclovir. Then coming to the another STI, that is condyloma acumenta or genital balls. This is one STI which European countries has, or this Western countries has, nowadays they have applied a break over it by starting vaccinating for this condyloma acumenta or genital balls. In India, awareness is still not much, but this is one STI which is preventable by vaccine, can be prevented by vaccination. Vaccination is not available for all the strains of this human papilloma virus, but mostly because it has a long-term complication of this carcinoma in the cervix in the females and carcinoma in the genital or the preputial or the penis area in the males. So that is preventable. So the main four serovores, so which are responsible for this transmission, vaccine against that is available. It's by name of Gardasil. So that is available, and it should be enclosed before the sexual activity in males and females starts. So its incubation period is quite long, 4 months to 6 months. most of the time appears on the vagina or in, or at penis near the anus, or can happen in the oral mucosa or throat also. This virus is can disseminate anywhere where contact to the person who is having the virus has occurred. Today, it's most of the time presents in small warty lesions or small fluff papules. It generally presents with green foamy vaginal discharge. Severe pruritus is there in these patients. And bacterial vaginosis, it is caused by mixed flora like Bartonella vaginalis and Mycoplasma hominis and other anaerobic bacteria. So pruritus is not prominent, but the discharge is very grey, homogeneous, and odor, a specific odor is there. Diagnosis, it's easily diagnosed by this microscope. Treatment, it depends on the specific agent which is responsible for this infection. Then pediculosis pubis, or it's this is caused by a small lice. Symptoms are most of the time itch in the genital or rectal area. Coming to PID, this is in females, many STDs, they mix up and cause the itches in the upper organs of the females also and the back area of this vaginal mucosa, then ovary, fallopian tube, and most of the time the cul-de-sac area behind the uterus that is involved, and the infection is extensive. That is called pelvic inflammatory disease. So WHO had designed one beautiful approach, syndromic management to STI. In syndromic management, because the burden of sexual diseases is too much. Too much burden on the society. So, the syndromic approach helps the healthcare provider. They make a provisional diagnosis depending upon some of the constellation of features like vaginal discharge, like urethral discharge, like pain during urination, like ulcer. So, depending upon that, there are seven syndromes which has designed by the WHO. And it has made the treatment of the STIs possible at the periphery level also. Although the accuracy is less, but still to provide treatment, it's very important to, because we want to decrease the male burden of this STDs as well as to the HIV also. STDs as such, all STDs, they increase the chances of HIV also. Because HIV, the viral load of HIV, it is more when there is any ulcer or any lesion over the pelvis. So already if a patient is having STD, then there will be more chances that he or she will contact HIV also from the second person. So WHO has designed this beautiful approach, syndromic management. Here clinical symptoms, a basis of the clinical signs and symptoms only, we determine the therapy, and it can be done at the periphery level also. So microbial agents are given depending upon the specific syndromes. So there are specific kits available. Depending upon the kits are provided depending upon the syndrome. So the advantage of this approach is it's simple, inexpensive, rapid, and can be implemented on large scale. And because a person from village, he or she might not come to a doctor at the district or at a medical college level, but he will, or she can go to his nearby service provider, like any nursing staff or any A&M, where at the PHC, he or she can visit. So thing is that this approach is a very fruitful approach, and it has given a fruitful results also in terms of the management of the SPID. So coming to the syndrome, first syndrome is of urethral discharge, second genital ulcer, third is inguinal bevo, then painful scrotal swelling, then your vaginal discharge, then lower abdominal pain, and then ophthalmia neonatal. So these are the main approach. Getting cure of the disease, and at the same time we should focus on contact tracing. So when he or she has got the STI, and then just to search and find him and him or her, and then his or her treatment is also important. So treatment of partner, contact tracing, correct and consistent use of condoms, then abstinence, then vaccination for this warts,
HPV.
These are all some of the approaches which basically can be strengthened at your level also. So, with this, I would like to finish my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Surinder. It was really a nice presentation, and I'm sure all the students were able to understand that there are certain signs and symptoms which can be, you know, known by any person. Most of the people, they are not aware they are having a problem, or they simply ignore. Like if there is some foul discharges, foul smelling discharges. So due to, and then they think it is only due to poor genital hygiene. But it is not. So, I mean, they are shy of sharing the problems. So, as a social worker, your role can be in proper sex education, in maintaining the genital hygiene. Your role there is very important. And if a person is having any of the problem on those seven syndromes which Dr. Surinder told us, you can ask the person to seek a medical advice. Because most of time they are not considered it as a treatable or curable disease. If I go into the history of STDs, so previously in ancient time it was considered as a curse, the sin of your, you know, or kind of past karmas. It was considered sometimes like a punishment for the blasphemic conduct. So it was, lot of rumors were there. In medieval time, gradually people were able to find that it is due to the sexual contact. It is not due to, any punishment by the God due to your misconduct or anything. And then in the beginning of the 20th century, when there was a lot of scientific advancement, microscopic availability, and again lot of chemicals through which you can stain the viruses or bacteria, then only we were able to establish the fact that all these STDs are due to certain virus, bacteria, protozoans, or other ectoparasites. So this is the history. So even now, the people of the lower socioeconomic strata, due to lack of proper sexual information, they don't seek medical advice. They opt to remain in the same situation. And then at the community level, disease spreads gradually. And it can be very easily preventable by the simple, correct and consistent use of condom, as Dr. Surinder said. 80 to 85% of STDs are simply preventable by the use of the proper use of the condoms. But people are shy of talking about condoms. So here, as a social worker, your role is to educate the people and go to the correct population, targeted population. It's very important. If we talk about HIV, so targeted population is very important. Sex workers, drug drivers, migrant laborers, or the population in which, the gay population, I must say, in which men, sex with men, all the STDs are more common. So the targeted interventions are important. So you have to identify the targeted audience, try to educate them, and then only we can able to, to control the spread of these STDs in our community. So, Dr. Vinita.
Yes, sir.
So, if you want to add something.
Yes. Shall we see whether students have any doubts, whether they can clarify?
Sure.
There is one question for Anima.
Yes.
Sir, if one partner is having STD, will the other partner also have? So I would like to answer that it will depend on the sexual practices which a person or the his partner is doing. Basically, it depends that whether if correct or consistent use of condom. It depends on this type of STD. First of all, a patient is having, then its incubation period. And then what are the preventive methods his or her partner is using? It will depend on all those things. It's a varied approach. Nowadays, we are seeing that the STD trend is changing. In the past, bacterial STDs were dominating, but nowadays only viral STIs are coming because there is already excessive use of antibiotics in the society. We get antibiotics for even a simple cough, and most of the time overuse of antibiotics is there. So bacterial STDs, most of the time they are just reducing to a very low level, and the viral STIs, they are increasing, like this herpes, like this genital warts, they are increasing nowadays in a very high level, and they both of them can be prevented by this consistent and correct use of condoms. Anyone having any question?
Students, please feel free to ask questions.
Anusha Getty, sir, can the STDs be identified in the very early stages and are they curable then? So I would like to reply that all the STDs except this HIV, all the STDs are curable at present. Means at early stage also and at the later stage also. Whatever damage they have caused or the stigma they have caused, that is different. But otherwise we are able to treat them at any stage. Okay. So whatever damage they have done, the damage will remain, but as such we are able to cure them. Except HIV, most all the STDs are right now they are curable. Any other question, please?
There is a question about condoms, whether they are 100% safe.
They are safe for the diseases which are being prevented by condom use. If like a condom is only weared over the penile part, if any person is having wart over this abdominal area, then it cannot be prevented. Basically, or with when one person is having this herpes infection at the lips, and he or she, her partner, is practicing oral sex, then means it will not be prevented, obviously, by use of condom. So the site which comes into contact, if a lesion is on the penis or the vulva, and that is fully covered by the penis, then it's almost 100, near to 100% preventable. One question is, if the mother has HIV AIDS and if she has a kid, will the kids also have AIDS? Yeah, there are chances. Mother to child transfer has already been reported, and it's very not very common, but still there are chances, around 20% chances, 20 to 30% chances that each kid will have HIV.
The condoms, they are made of rubber latex, so whether they will be harmful?
Rubber can only make a harm if anyone is allergic to rubber. If someone is having allergic contact dermatitis to rubber, then only it can cause allergic contact dermatitis. Otherwise, it's safe.
Regarding masturbation.
Nowadays, people are more into masturbation. This particular activity will cause of vaginal issues. Not getting the kisses, basically. What's of this STD as well as HIV to a very low level. This use of condom is medically proven that they are helpful. And one another question is, AIDS is curable? No, till date. HIV AIDS is the only STI which is not curable. It's treatable. It's treatable, and the patient lives for years after treatment, but it's not curable still. STD, whom to approach, keeping the privacy of the person. So I think best will be to visit a dermatologist. Every doctor wants to keep it, or it's doctor's duty to keep a patient's sexual history private. So without any doubt, you can go to a dermatologist, and he or she will advise you, because it's the duty of a doctor to not to discuss any of your part of your sexual history with anyone. So please don't have any panic, and just ask the person to discuss with a dermatologist or a venereologist. Can dental dams be used to prevent STIs? I am sorry, dental dams, I don't know. Swamil, have you heard of dental dams?
No, not.
The question is not clear, student.
Sexual activity. Okay. So, how they will prevent STI? Question is the answer. I
think. Unless it is not used by multiple persons.
Multiple persons. Then
yes,
it's safe.
Any other questions, students?
Any symptoms about having STD or HIV? Okay, that's what we were discussing in this presentation. So, symptoms are like anyone having any ulcer, any discharge from the urethra or from the VATS, and any papules over the penis, or any solid elevated lesion, any lesion on the penis, any rash on the genital area, that may be suspected for STD, and then person should consult to the venereologist or a dermatologist.
Could be also burning pain during the urination. It is suspected of STD, not the clear-cut symptom, because there could be a lot of other, you know, cases where there is a burning sensation during urine passing. So it's not the only things. That's why Dr. Surinder said it could be, has to be verified. Otherwise, you have taken less water and you got some burning sensation and during passing of urine and you are suspecting it could be STD. It's not like that. So
yes, I don't think. Yes. May I request our Vice Principal Madam, Dr. Janice Mary, to address her? Dr. Janice Mary, please.
Respected Principal Dr. Juliet C.J., our Registrar Professor Vinita Roy, Secretary Sugam Foundation Dr. Swamil Rastatri, Speaker of the Day Dr. Surendra Kumar, my dear colleagues and my students. The professional social workers are trained to work for the society by networking with the government organizations, human service organizations, and the corporate sector. The profession offers a wide scope to work with the entire humanity. Hence, the baby boomers and the budding professionals need to be trained to address the health concerns of our country as well as the world. School of Social Work, Goshala, is grateful to Sugam Foundation, Delhi, for collaborating with us for this program on sexually transmitted diseases Thank you, Dr. Samil Restaji, for your wonderful keynote address. I'm sure the speaker of the day, Dr. Surendra Kumar, has equipped us with the knowledge on STD, which will be used for our field work as well as when we are working with the people. I must acknowledge and appreciate Professor Vinita Rai, our registrar, for always walking with our students extra miles with great zeal and commitment. I am happy that our students have participated in this webinar in a very active manner, putting across a lot of questions and seeking clarity. We look forward for such programs in the future also. God bless you all.
Thank you, madam. Now may I request our principal, madam, Dr. Juliet C.J., deliver the presidential address.
Good evening, everybody. This was a very good learning session, which is indicated by a number of indicators that we have seen. Number one, our students have really asked relevant questions, good questions, and they have clarified doubts. Secondly, there has been a lot of interactions on scientific as well as practical aspects. Respected Dr. Somil Rastogi, the trustee and secretary of Sugam Foundation, thank you very much for collaborating with Roshni Nilaya, School of Social Work Roshni Nilaya, and having this program for our students, for our faculty. I thank you once again for your keynote address, which was really eye-opening. I also thank Dr. Surendra Kumar for being detailed, for the detailed explanations on the scientific aspects of STIs. I would like to just mention that School of Social Work trains students to involve in trauma counseling, in crisis counseling, and casework, social casework. Social casework is like counseling, wherein they involve with individual problems in the community. So I'm sure the session that our students have attended today is going to be of great help in their fieldwork activities. My one suggestion to you students is that you need to identify the high-risk population and have targeted interventions, as Dr. Sunil has rightly said, to educate people in groups. Maybe I was just going through one study wherein they have studied about the stigma associated with sexually transmitted infections. So in this study, it was said it is homemakers were not ready to respond, and the first time diagnosed symptomatic cases were also not ready to respond. Only 10% of the total selected respondents actually turned up for the interview. So this shows homemakers groups and people, youth groups need to be addressed. So in our communities, when we go for field work in the villages as well as in the urban communities, let us try to form groups, educational groups of youth, wherein one session or a group, a series of sessions could be organized with experts, doctors, and make this kind of awareness wider among the couple groups and youth groups. So I once again congratulate Professor Vinita K, the HOD of BSW department, as well as the entire BSW department faculty and students for organizing this along with Sugam Foundation. And I believe this is not just a beginning, but a process which we will continue in the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you, madam. With this, we come to the end of the webinar by delivering the vote of thanks. Yes, it's our pleasure to express our sense of gratitude to Dr. Sunil Rastogi, Trustee and Secretary, Sukham Foundation, New Delhi, for accepting our invitation. Generally, doctor was surprised when I said sexually transmitted diseases, because people generally don't like to discuss about these things. People shy away. So, but today we got an opportunity to have interaction with the doctor, and then our students also could clarify their doubts. So thank you for the motivational keynote address and for your support. We look forward for such opportunity in the future also. Thank you very much, Dr. Sunil Rastogi. Then, yes, very important. We need scientific knowledge. Many a times we are confused, especially with this WhatsApp university, we are confused. Whereas Dr. Surendra Kumar has given us the scientific knowledge about the sexually transmitted infection and then sexually transmitted diseases. And on behalf of School of Social Work, Roshni Ilaiya, we extend our heartfelt gratitude to you. In spite of your busy schedule with this, during this pandemic, you have kept some time for us to enlighten us on the topic. Thank you very much, sir. We are grateful to you, sir. At the same time, indeed, it is our pleasure to thank our principal madam, who is the backbone, who is all the time supporting in all our activities. Thank you, Dr. Julius CJ, for your encouragement and support. Then, very important is our vice principal, Dr. Jenis Mary, who is always with us to support us, to guide us in all our activities. And very patiently you have stayed back with us to participate in this webinar. Thank you very much, Dr. Jenis Mary. And today I would like to appreciate a final year BSW student, Manoj Bhatt, who was instrumental in